This movie is a continuation of our last clip where you saw number 51 switcher, and it was pulling a couple freight cars up on a table. So in order to prevent any disasters here, I put this locomotive, number 2025, with some 1940s freights down on the floor. And we have our controller, and here's my little remote that I built. Gives you three speeds, and everything is contained in that house you see over there. So I'm going to run it for a couple laps on what I call medium speed. I'm going to slow down and stop to unload our logs. Hopefully we're in a good spot for that. Well, we spilled a few, but probably we're close enough. So let's get going again and get her up to medium. And last but not least, I'm going to flip to high speed, not for long. And as you can see, it's really ripping along in danger of going off the track. So I'm slowing back down to medium. Okay, so that's going to end that, and I'm going to give you just a couple of comments about this. I thought it was going to be fairly easy to just change taps on the transformer, but I had to put some diode bridges in series with it to drop the voltage from 15. This locomotive turns out to have a narrow band where it runs well, starts at 12, and pretty much at 14 it's running flat out. So there really isn't much room to set your voltages, so you have to kind of cheat with some semiconductors, and that's what I did. So my next attempt is going to be to run a standard gauge. We'll see how that works out. So I hope you've enjoyed this clip. It took a fair amount of work, even though it doesn't look like much more than the previous one. Thanks for watching. So one day after I finished my O gauge, I decided, well, let's see what's going to happen with standard gauge. And I wanted to tread into this carefully, so I brought out this Ives passenger set, although it's a freight station. And this one can reverse. Right now it's stopped. So let's let it go on the slowest speed. Now this was the slowest speed that ran the 2025 O-gauge locomotive. And you can see it's pretty respectable with this. Stop it. You can back up. Stop and go forward. And I'm going to move to the middle speed. And it takes a while for it to get up ahead of steam, but as you can see, that's really fast. So I'm going to slow it down. We can't go for the fastest speed because clearly it would derail. But here we go with an Ives, and I'm hoping that with a little bit of tweak, we can put on a standard gauge steam set with freight cars and see how that makes out with this. So again, hope you enjoyed watching this clip, and there will be more. And at the end, I'm going to do some commentary on what I've gone through in these passing weeks. Thanks for watching. Come to the end of our railroading adventure, and again our train controller is still housed in that freight station over there. So now we've moved up to standard gauge, still have our little three-stage controller here, and I can stop it, and this guy's pretty noisy when he runs. This is our medium speed, and our slow speed just kind of crawls around, but it makes it, but not by a whole lot. And high speed. takes it a minute to pick up speed, but it, you know, it goes cranking along pretty well. So what I'm going to do is slow this down to medium speed and see what happens here. This guy can reverse. And I don't know whether I have it in the right position yet or not. There he goes. So as you can see, at this speed, he reverses fairly nicely. And stop it again. And then he luckily goes forward. So, you know, pretty much with his standard gauge locomotive, this great brass Piper, we can do the same thing as we did with O-gauge. And this takes all the voltage that that apparatus can produce. I'm going to stop the engine. And I have a couple of still pictures. I want to do some explanation as to what's in that controller and what I had to do to make everything work properly to get the three speeds with the different locomotives. I hope you've enjoyed the series, and as I said, I'm going to continue with a little bit more discussion from a couple of still photos. Hope you enjoyed seeing this great old engine run. I've had some real fun doing it. So hang on for a moment and we'll talk a little more. Here's a video clip that you saw in part one of this series with the number 51 switcher, but I put some annotation on it. It shows the Uno microcontroller on the bottom of the train platform. And what I did, because I was afraid of short circuits, I put in an automotive fuse. And in order to get some of the drops that were necessary, I took one of these full-wave diode bridge rectifiers and soldered the plus and minus together. And this gives you essentially two forward diode drops in each direction, meaning you lose about 1.25 volts through it. And this was the only way I found to get some of the voltages near where they needed to be. It doesn't use a whole lot of power. The diode curves are fairly sharp and they don't get hot. You do waste a little bit of power, but they seem pretty effective. And there's also one available for the top. Some of the number 2025 locomotive you saw earlier used two of these rectifiers. And I'm going to go to the next slide and talk a little bit about fusing and circuit protection. So with that, let's move on. What I found was that after I put the 2025 on the track, I had some derailments occasionally, particularly when I backed up and one of the cars wasn't quite in the right position, and that would blow the fuse. And after blowing about a half a dozen fuses, I said, this is too much, it has to go. So I had purchased a circuit breaker that I used in another one of my videos some time ago, and I just used double-sided tape and put the circuit breaker, which is a 7.5 amp, on the bottom of the platform. And I've blown this a couple of times, so it's really a godsend insofar as saving fuses. So again, that's what the underside of the platform currently looks like when you saw the brass Piper running. Now I have one more comment to make on one more slide, and that will be it. So hang on for a second. So here we are back to the top of the freight station, and I just wanted to give you one more glimpse of everything that's in it. I left the little house to the left of the electronics, and I put a rubber band around some of the loose wires because it was very, very difficult to slide the house over the top. And on the top of the relay card, you can see another one of those full-wave bridge rectifiers. So we have two transformers here. One can produce plus and minus 6. That's the one that's buried under the relay card. And the one that's standing vertically with the big brass screw sticking out of it can produce plus and minus 3.1. So added together, we can get up to 18 volts. And we can do various add tracks of the windings
to get multiples of 3 volts pretty much wherever you want them. And multiples of 3 didn't necessarily work right, which is why you see the bridge rectifiers and the easy way to drop a couple of volts of voltage. So if you needed to drop 2 volts, which I think I did in one case, you'd put a couple of these rectifiers together. So that's the story on some of the things that were done here. I hope you've enjoyed the video series, and we'll see what we can bring out for you next. But in the meantime, thanks for watching. Stay safe. Have a great day.